My friend was driving down a two-lane road at highway speed when a car suddenly turned right in front of her. She didn't have time to do anything but wait for the crashing of metal. But then God stepped in and did something wonderful. You'll find out what that was next on this episode of Better Life Today. Hello and welcome to this episode of Better Life Today. With me is Sayuri Rodriguez. Sayuri, welcome.
Thank you.
We're doing another Stories of Faith program.
Yes, our favorite.
Because the Lord keeps showing us stories of things that He's done over and over again.
Amen.
You know, we've been talking in the past episodes about your foster kids when you had them. And since we started, you had them for 7 months and then they got moved to a relative's home out of state. And do you have any updates of how they're doing?
You know, everybody keeps asking us, but yes, we got a text from the new mom recently, and she just mentioned that they're doing good little by little. Every day gets a little bit better. She mentioned that the kids ask for us a lot. We miss them very much. We know that they miss us, and we are praying, and we know that God willing, soon we might be able to FaceTime with them or talk to them, and we look forward to that. Oh. And it was really interesting because I was speaking at the Church of Roseburg recently, and they've heard little things here and there about the kids, and I decided to give a couple of illustrations during the message about the kids. And towards the end of the message, we were talking about how Jesus is coming soon and how He's making His final call for His children. And I illustrated that by sharing how when the kids were leaving, we were like, oh, don't forget this, and, you know, and love the Lord, don't forget Jesus, and just trying so much to give last-minute
instructions
to the kids. And then towards the end, we decided to have family worship, and that was going to be the last thing we were going to do together. So we went to the living room, and we started singing a song, and as the four of us are singing the song, I think all of us realize that the words of this song was what we had in our heart for each other, our desires, which was heaven is our goal, and meet me in heaven. We'll join hands together. Meet me at the Savior's side. I'll meet you in heaven. You know, we'll sing songs together again. This is not it. Remember Savior Fork, remember? Just meet me in heaven. That's our prayer for them, but also their prayer, their little prayer for us too, you know. We may not be able to see each other again, but we have the hope that one day soon we will be able to meet in heaven with the Lord.
The song that you're referring to is called Side by Side.
Side by Side.
And it was written by a friend of mine. And I think it's been used by a lot of people,
you know,
especially when you part or finish maybe school or something. You sing that song to remind each other, let's be together in heaven.
When we were singing that song, there were times that it was just the guitar playing because we were just in tears. And then we would come back strong and start singing. It's just a beautiful song, you know. And that's our desire for our viewers as well. We want to be able to all join Jesus that wonderful day that is coming soon.
We should have two big goals in our life.
Amen.
One is to accept Christ's salvation for ourselves. That should be our number one goal. And then to bring as many people as we can with us.
Yes.
That's our second big goal. And that includes your family, you
know. That's right.
It just includes everybody.
And that's what the song says. Heaven is our goal
to save every soul.
Every
soul, yes. Well, what is our Bible? Well, our theme for today, I should say. Theme for the stories today is miracle rescues. When God steps in to help us out of situations. And we had a few stories that show miracle rescues. And so we wanted that to be our theme. And our Bible text, would you read our Bible text
for today? Yes, it's beautiful. It's in Deuteronomy 31, verse 6. And it says, be strong and of good courage. Do not fear nor be afraid of them. For the Lord your God, He is the one who goes with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you.
I like that verse because when we give ourselves to the Lord and we say, yes, we're going to obey you and yes, we're going to follow you, we become, I like to say, we become his problem. That is to say, all of our problems we give to him. All of our plans we can give to him. And when you're a little kid, that's, you know, there's some comfort to that. Mom and dad are going to take care of it. I don't have to worry about the rent. Mom and dad are going to take care of it. I don't have to worry about the bills. And in the same sense, we're giving that same thing over to God when we're adults. We can say, Lord, I'm your problem now. You have to take care of me because you love me. And that's what we do. I think I've done that myself. You know, times get tough.
Many times.
And you're starting to think to yourself, I don't know how to get out of this predicament. But Lord, you know, I'm giving myself to you. It's your problem. And I don't think he minds that. I think he likes it when we come to him and say, okay, I'm here to help you. I'm here to take care of this.
And you know, that reminds me of a quote that you mentioned one time that says that the Lord loves that his children ask of him the things that we cannot do ourselves.
Yes, yes.
That is beautiful.
Yeah. Because God asks us to do some things. I mean, he's given us bodies and minds and hands and feet to do things. He asks us to do something. But there are things that we cannot do. It's impossible. And he wants us to lean on him for those things that we cannot do. And then he enjoys seeing us do the things we can do.
Amen.
Yeah. Well, let's get into the stories because we've got a number of them today, and I'm sure the audience wants to hear them. I wanted to start off with a story. You know, we've been asking around for people to tell us their stories, and a church member stopped me and said, or called me or something, and said, I've got a story to share. And when I went over to their house to hear the story, there was actually two stories.
Oh.
So I'm going to tell you the first story because it's a little shorter now, and then a little later in the program, I'll talk about the one about her going down the highway, and the car turns right in front of her, and she's sure that there's going to be a terrible crash. I'll tell that one in a little bit.
Wow.
But the first one she told me was happened at her home. And she said that she was home, and she had gone to see a piece of clothing. She had found a piece of clothing. She said, I wonder if this still looks good. I'm going to try. I need to find a mirror. So she took the piece of clothing and headed for a mirror. And when she started to get to a place, she said her foot had rubber shoes on, and the soles, the rubber soles, got caught on the carpet, and she fell.
Oh.
Now, she said she didn't have her walker with her at this time. She was just doing a freestanding thing, and that probably wasn't a good idea. And she'd walked into the hallway. Now, the hallway was carpeted, but the way she was falling was not in the hallway.
Oh,
the way she ended up falling was in the guest bathroom. And you want to know what was on the floor in the guest bathroom? Hard tile.
Oh.
It was not a good place to fall. She's falling down. Now, she's getting ready to take a trip to San Diego. And as she's falling, you know what goes through her mind? I'm going to break my hip, and I'm not going to be able to go to the trip to San Diego.
And it's like slow motion.
Yeah, you know, you think whenever things happen, sometimes you'd be surprised what comes to mind. That's what came to her mind. So she's fallen, and she hits the hard tile of the guest bathroom. But, you know, she checks. And even though she fell on her hip, and she fell on her elbow, she's okay. She's okay. Oh, she was so glad.
Did she hold on to something?
No, she didn't tell me. She said she just fell down, fell down. So I don't think she grabbed a hold of anything. Now, here's the part of the story I especially like. A couple days later, she's either taking or picking up her husband. He helps at the blood drive. You know where they do donations of blood?
The Red Cross?
Yeah, the Red Cross thing. She goes to either pick up or drop off her husband at the blood drive, I think that here at the church probably, and she starts talking to a lady. Now this lady, her name is Joy, and my friend's name is Fran. Well, they're both my friends, but Fran is the one who fell. Joy starts talking to her and saying, you know what happened a couple days ago? I had the strongest impression that I needed to pray for you by name.
Oh.
She goes, you did? She goes, what time did that happen? And they started to compare notes, as it were. The same time she was falling,
she was praying.
This other lady was praying.
Wow.
The same time she was falling, this other lady was impressed.
Praise
you
God.
Need to pray for your friend.
Hmm.
And the Lord answered her prayer.
Praise God.
Have you heard of that happening before, where people are kind of impressed. You need to pray for this person. Mm-hmm. You need to pray mm-hmm. for that person. And then they later find out that at that time, that person was going through something they really needed help with.
That usually happens to me at nighttime.
Yeah.
I wake up with a name, and I don't, of someone that I haven't talked to in a long time, just randomly, and I just start praying constantly, constantly. Not too long ago, I woke up even saying the name. Usually it's just in my mind, and I just pray quietly because yeah. my husband's sleeping. Uh-huh. This time, I woke up saying, Stephanie. And I just prayed for her. But now that you mentioned this story, I'm going to call her and see.
Find out if there was something happening for Stephanie.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So we need to pray for each other. That's, you know, part of our part in this world, in this great controversy against Satan. Part of the power comes from prayer. Mm-hmm. The Lord has ordained that we are to use prayer to help win battles against Satan mm-hmm. and, you know, to keep us safe. Mm-hmm. So don't forget that, friends. Remember to pray.
Amen.
Now, you had some stories that you wanted to mention.
Yes. One story that I have, and this happened to me some years ago. I was in California, mm-hmm. and I don't know if you know the area of St. Helena.
Oh, yes, Northern California.
Northern California, yeah. Anwin, this little town. And I had been asked to go and work in Maryland. Mm-hmm. And I could have just, you know, taken a flight and go over there, taken an airplane. But I decided I was going to take my car. It was going to take me 4 days. Now, I had done driving here and there by myself, you know, but 4 days by myself, my parents were not very happy. They were kind of concerned for me. And but I was, no, everything's going to be okay. The Lord and I are going to take this trip. For me, it's going to be a wonderful time spent, just the Lord and I.
So you were excited.
Yeah, I was very excited uh-huh. to go there. And so the day came, I had all my things in my car. And I started driving. Music, I had music on one side, you know, water bottles and all these different things. Mm-hmm. And as I was driving, the first thing that happened is that I had my plan. You know, I did not have a phone like we have phones right now that tell you, you know, you go this way and that way. I had a big map, you know, the ones that you like
yes.
get lost. So I had one of those. And for those of you that know me, I'm very bad with directions. And so everybody was telling me, you're supposed to get there in 4 days. Yeah, you're going to get there in 10 days or something because you're going to get lost. But I remember driving. The first thing that started happening is as I was driving, I was not prepared for the weather. Mm. And the first thing that happened was snow.
Oh.
Lots of snow. And I'm thinking, oh, no, I need chains. And I'm just driving like this. Lord, it's just you and I. Help me. I drove through the snow. I remember calling my parents and saying, you know, I just went through this snowstorm. And they were just constantly praying for me. And as I kept driving, other things started happening.
Well, before you go further, though, this is probably a good time for us to take a break. So. So, friends, we're going to be right back. But we want to take a short break and then let Sayuri tell the rest of her story of how she tries to make it across the United States, just her and the Lord. Yeah. We'll find out next, right after this. Hello, and welcome back to Better Life Today. We're telling stories of faith. And as we left the program, Sayuri, you were telling a story about how you traveled across the United States by yourself, mm-hmm. in your car, thinking it was just you and the Lord. Your parents were worried, and shortly after you started, you ran into problems with snow.
Snow.
What happened?
First, it was snow, and I love snow, mm-hmm. but this was a storm, and I remember just praying, God, and I was recording myself. Don't worry, it was safe, and I remember just telling everybody in my whole recording of the whole journey, mm-hmm. saying, don't worry. We're okay. It's the Lord and I. Well, in the snow, the Lord and I, help me, Lord, you know, and trusting the Lord to get me. He did get me through it. The hardest part for me to drive through was through Chicago.
Oh.
Oh, wow. Rain. Strong, strong rain. And you know what was the worst thing? Hmm. I didn't know how to get defrost?
Defroster, yeah.
Yes. And so it was getting all foggy, and I couldn't see, and there's rain, and there's traffic, a lot of traffic. I remember thinking, maybe if I open the window, well, the rain was coming in. And yet, I am so surprised, but the Lord got me through there. And then I had to spend the night in hotels. in one hotel. I spent the night, and I remember just being so tired of driving the whole day. And I got my things that I was going to take inside the room, and I went into the room, and I'm in the room, and I'm laying down just sleeping and thinking, okay, tomorrow I'll wake up early. And it's not a very safe zone where I was at, but, you know, it was close to the freeway, mm-hmm. so that I could just wake up, get into the car, and continue. In the middle of the night, I wake up thinking, where's my laptop? And I start looking for my laptop, and I can't find it. I'm thinking, maybe I left it in the car. And I don't want to get up, and it's scary, it's dark. So I thought, well, tomorrow morning I'll check. But my mind just, you know, it's the Lord saying, you know, check for your laptop. And I remember opening the door just to check and see in the car, my laptop was right next to the car.
Outside?
See, outside. I had gotten all these different things. I must have put it on the floor for something. And I went inside forgetting my laptop. So immediately I went outside, I grabbed my laptop and went in. But I remember thinking it was just so easy. Cars, trucks, everybody goes by there. And nobody, thank God, was able to see it. Now, when I get to Maryland, I had already done my research and decided this is the place where I'm going to go and rent. I had called the person. They said, yes, come. This is the address. Mm-hmm. And you come with the check. Be ready. And we're going to be there to get the check, and then we can give you the keys for your apartment. When I saw the address, and I got to Maryland, and I was looking for this address, the address was this horrible area. I would say
Like a ghetto.
Very, very bad. And I remember thinking, is this it? And then the address that they gave me, just really there was nothing. Uh-huh. I mean, there were buildings here and there, people. It was just really bad. And I remember thinking, you know, there's somebody there who looks like he's waiting for someone. I could just get out of my car and with my check, right? Uh-huh. And then they'll tell me where's the address. But God, you know, impressed, just keep on driving.
Stay in the car,
don't get out. And I didn't. And so I had to stay that first night in a hotel thinking, these people, they just wanted my money and who knows what was gonna happen. But now where am I gonna leave? I need to start work soon and what's gonna happen? I remember that on the Craigslist that I had been checking, there was an ad that said, needed Christian roommate. Mm. And I had called that place and nobody had answered, so then that's how I ended up in calling that other place. So I go back to Craigslist to see if this ad for Christian roommate is still on. It was gone. It was not there. Mm. And I thought, oh, well. But you know what? I think I have the number here, so I'm going to call. I called the number, and this girl answered, and I said, you know, I'm calling because you posted an ad, and I was wondering if you still have this apartment for rent or this room. And she said, yes, I still have it. Come and see me. And it's the most wonderful place to be, safe area, and how the Lord protected me for 4 days is just incredible. I did make it in 4 days, not 10 days. And so that is the Lord.
You didn't know what dangers were out there.
No.
You thought, oh, I'll just go out. There's going to be no problem. But after you left, you found out there are dangers.
Yes.
And the Lord knew them.
Amen.
And he helped guide you through
that. He helped me.
Wow.
Amen.
That is amazing. Well, are you ready for the dramatic story now? Yeah. This is the story I started with. The lady who was driving her car. I want to make sure I get all the details. So let me pull up the notes I had here. I went over and talked to her, and she shared this story. And you know, it brought tears to her eyes to think about how the Lord had saved her. Mm. And I think you'll understand when I get to the end. This is my friend Fran again, you know, the one that had fallen and the lady was praying for her and she didn't break anything. This is the same lady, Fran. Fran, at this time, this happened back in 1978. She was living down in Yucaipa, which is by San Bernardino, down in Southern California. And she was living down there and she was having a terrible time with allergies. She had arthritis. It was not feeling good. Mm-hmm. She needed to go to the store. So she went out and got in her car and headed on out. She was going down the road and I said, how fast were you going? She said about 55 miles an hour on a 2-lane road. You know, one was, she was going this way. Other cars were going the opposite way. And it was just this little road. She was heading to the supermarket, going down that road. She said there really were no turn lanes. Mm. Really, it sounds pretty narrow or something. Then all of a sudden, she says, a car that was coming towards her turned right in front of her, like he didn't even see her. So a car is coming towards her, turns right in front of her, and at that moment, at that instant, she exclaims, "Oh, Jesus!" You know, I consider that a little prayer.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
you don't have time definitely. To do anything else. You just call
on the name of the
on
Lord.
On the name of the Lord. And all she had time to do is she says, "I was expecting the crash, the sound of metal, glass breaking." She said, "I just knew that was coming. There was no way out of it." But God had a surprise for her. I mean, she never would have imagined what happened next. And she tells me that all of a sudden, everything went silent. She said it was the deepest silence she had ever experienced. The car, silent. Her heartbeat, she couldn't hear it. Everything, just silent, completely silent. And she said at the same time, her car was wrapped in like a cloud. She said, "You know what it's like when you're flying in a plane and you go into a cloud and you look out the window and all you see is
just
the
white. Yes.
She said, "That's how it was in the car. I was enveloped in a cloud." So here she's driving along, about to have an accident. She knows it's going to crash. It goes silent. She's enveloped in a cloud. The next thing she knows is when it clears away and she realizes where she is, her car is now on the opposite side, off of the road, on a corner lot that is concrete, stopped, sitting there. So you see what happened? It was like the Lord picked up her car at that second, moved it over to this empty, vacant lot on the other side of the road. She wasn't even on the road. She was on the lot.
Wow.
And that's where she was. Oh. And she was shaking. And I said, what was this lot? She goes, "Well, they used to have motorhomes on it, and then they had cleared it off. For some reason, it was probably, I don't know what they were using it for. But at that moment, it was clear.
Wow.
Just concrete-like.
Oh.
So she's sitting there shaking,
mm-hmm.
trying to process what just happened.
Right.
Totally out of the blue. She looks over, and there's the guy who had made the turn. He's still there. So she's thinking, I got to go talk to him. But her legs are not steady. You know how you feel after one of these events. But she gets out and goes over to the guy. The guy rolls down the window. And you know what he said? He's an older guy. You know what he says to her? He says, "Boy, that could have been, you know, that could have been bad."
So, yeah.
It was like he didn't realize exactly what had happened.
Huh.
But he knew that it was a situation that was going to be bad. And she goes, "Didn't you see me? I'm driving a red car." And he just, you know, just probably, he didn't fully understand what was happening in the situation, I don't think.
I wonder what he saw.
I was curious too, but he didn't say anything about it. And she was so shaken up, I don't think she asked any further questions.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what she told me after the fact was, as she thought back on those years, back in 1978, she says, "You know, I didn't really have a good connection with the Lord right then, at that moment." She says, "And I'm worried that if I had died right then, that I would not have been saved." So I said, "Well, you know, the Lord was probably sparing your life so that you could get that reconnection with Him." And
that's amazing. Wow.
Yeah, that really startled her. But that's one of the more dramatic rescues from a car accident that I've ever heard of.
In a cloud.
Rescued in a cloud. That's kind of nice.
That is. You know, you don't see anything bad and it can be so scary. So that is a way to go. Wow.
Did you have a story you wanted to share?
I do have a story. This story happened with some friends. Mm-hmm. We were visiting and we were in Chico. And we decided to go and walk around the
train depot? Train tracks?
Train tracks, yes. And as we were walking on the train tracks, there was this tunnel. And we decided to go inside. You know, the train's not there. So we start walking, and it was a long tunnel. So we start walking and walking in the middle of the trucks. And there's a group of, I would say, maybe like 10 of us. Mm-hmm. And we're laughing, and we're just having a good time. And in the middle, we could still see that, you know, it's way out there. Let's just go back. And I do remember that as we were walking over there, I was thinking, "Lord, let no train come right now, please, because there's nowhere to go. It's just very narrow."
So you're telling me that you were going into the tunnel?
Went into the tunnel.
But you didn't make it to the end?
No, we didn't. In the middle of the tunnel, someone said, "You know, maybe we should just go back."
Yeah.
You know, we need to go back. As we're walking back, we're getting close to the exit and we hear the train coming. So if we had kept going, it would have just hit us immediately, right away. So we just got out, and I just started praising God, because really, it was so narrow that there was no way of just avoiding the train. It would have just run over us. And I remember thinking, the Lord saved us, you know, from something that could have been very horrible. And
you know, we need to listen to the Lord's voice, that still small voice, the Holy Spirit or the angels that come to whisper us to say, this is not a good place to be. Don't do this, or get out, or whatever.
Turn back.
Yeah, turn back, whatever the message is. Because we tend to get ourselves in foolish situations, you know. And when you're younger, especially, you've heard of a lot of kids, they go do things because they have no conception that it's really dangerous. Oh, they'll live forever. They're young kids. And I wonder how busy we keep our angels, because we do things that are stupid.
We'll find out.
And the Lord helps us still. Yeah.
We'll see. And many of those things, we know how the Lord delivered us. Yeah. But there will be things that we would see, we would realize, wow, we didn't even know that we were in such danger and how God helped us.
Well, I'm very curious when I get to heaven, because I'm sure there's more episodes of stories of faith is going to happen in heaven when we learn about all the things that God has done.
That's right.
I know of some, you know, but we don't know it all. And we're going to be amazed.
Amen.
Well, friends, I've shared some stories that have been shared with us from people who said, yeah, I've got a story of faith. I've got something that happened to me. If you have a story that you want to share with us, there's a number on the screen you can call. We'd love to hear from you. You can mail us if you'd like. But we'd like to hear your story. And if you say, well, I don't want to write it up, I just want to tell you, that's fine. I'll listen to you. I'll record it maybe. I'll write it down. And then we can share your story of faith. Because I know the Lord is busy out there. We know He's doing things all the time. And when we share it, we glorify His name.
We glorify His name, and we encourage one another.
That's right. So we want to encourage you folks, stay close to the Lord, do what He says, accept His salvation, and you're going to see some amazing things now and after He comes to get us.
Amen.
Tune in for the next Better Life Today.